Remember how we were speculating that SpaceX's Starship could be used as a military transporter to deliver troops and cargo to anywhere on Earth in about 30 minutes? Well, apparently now the Pentagon also realized that it might be highly beneficial strategically to employ SpaceX rockets for exactly such a scenario. Then, still regarding SpaceX, Crew 1 has been delayed. Why? What's going on there? Oh, and we also have to talk about the SpaceX lawsuit against the US Air Force.
Then Chris Ferguson, the astronaut who would have flown on the first manned Boeing Starliner flight, withdraws from this mission. But what could be the reasons for that decision? Then the Space Force considers merging Cape Canaveral with the Kennedy Space Center. And NASA is already preparing their deep space communications network for the Artemis moon missions. And of course, we have to give our mandatory update on the progress of Starship and Super Heavy at Boca Chica. A lot to talk about again, so stay tuned.
You know that we often like to speculate about stuff and make predictions. This is of course dangerous sometimes because of course we might be brutally wrong. But on the other hand, it's quite nice when we are right. And apparently our idea of using Starship as a military troop transporter is not as far-fetched as it seemed almost a year ago when we first mentioned this idea. Because now the Pentagon's Transportation Command is teaming up with SpaceX to examine the possibility of using their rockets to ship cargo to anywhere on Earth in under 1 hour. General Stephen R. Lyons, the head of Transportation Command, described it like this. Think about moving the equivalent of a C-17 payload anywhere on the globe in less than 1 hour.
The C-17 is a military cargo transporter airplane, which can carry about 85 metric tons of cargo. Now this is highly interesting. SpaceX currently does not have a rocket in operation that can carry such an amount of payload. But of course, our smart viewers already know that SpaceX has a rocket system under development, which would be able to carry such massive payloads. Exactly. General Lyons is of course talking about Starship. Starship is the only vehicle currently in development worldwide, which would enable a rapid deployment of 100 metric tons of cargo to anywhere on Earth in under 1 hour. General Lyons explains that there are two possible modes of transport being examined. One involves a straightforward flight from a space base in the continental US abroad. The second involves pre-positioning supplies in orbit on a spacecraft that could quickly deorbit and land when necessary. Both could deliver goods in about an hour or less. Imagine the insane strategic advantage one would have over an enemy in an armed conflict if you could send some starships for resupply to anywhere on Earth in under 1 hour, delivering hundreds of tons of cargo, and in the future, of course, also troops. It is clear why the US military would be highly interested in such a capability. A flight from California to Japan in a C-17 Globemaster III costs $312,000 one way. Starship will cost $2 million per flight, as Elon has stated, but the insane time advantage might be worth the extra cost in a scenario where time is of utmost importance. So yes, we think that the US military seriously considering such options already shows that Starship will very likely be also employed as a military troop transporter of sorts. Certainly for cargo, but at some point later, also very likely for troops. Because come on, then we would really have Starship troopers in the truest sense of the word. How crazy would that be?
Still on the topic of SpaceX, the start of the Crew 1 mission with Crew Dragon to the ISS has been delayed due to an anomaly in the Falcon 9's first stage Merlin engines, which had been observed in a previous SpaceX mission. SpaceX is investigating the cause for this anomaly, but as we know, SpaceX is very determined at fixing issues very fast. The new launch date will now be sometime in early to mid-November. Well, we think it's better to be safe than sorry. And please consider subscribing to our channel. Why? Because we are totally anti-PC nonsense and we brutally bash companies which employ unfair means such as lobbyism in order to compensate for their own inefficiency, such as Boeing, Blue Origin and others. Thank you very much and we really appreciate your support. Regarding the lawsuit of SpaceX against the US Air Force for unfairly awarding launch contracts to ULA, Northrop Grumman and Blue Origin back in 2018, the lawsuit has now been ended. After the Court of Federal Claims ruled that it lacked jurisdiction, the case was transferred in August 2019 to the US District Court of the Central District of California. Judge Otis D. Wright II of the US District Court for the Central District of California released a two-page filing on the 2nd of October showing that SpaceX, its rivals and the government have signed off on the court's sealed September 24th ruling that SpaceX's protest lacked merit. Probably SpaceX was fine with that decision since the Pentagon announced on August 7th this year that they would choose SpaceX and ULA as its main launch providers to carry out launches from 2022 to 2027. Blue Origin and Northrop were left out. So yeah, at least the Pentagon realized that SpaceX is a better option than Blue Origin and Northrop. But of course, they are still obliged by politics to choose ULA alongside with SpaceX, even though we all know who has the more advanced technology. Well, still better than nothing, we guess. The idea also was for SpaceX to get some additional funding for Starship development from these US Air Force contracts. But we all know by now that SpaceX doesn't really need any exterior funding for the Starship to succeed. SpaceX is growing like crazy and will have such insane revenue in large parts thanks to Starlink that Starship will be built even without heavy support from the Air Force.
And at Boca Chica, Starship SN8 is being prepared to get 3 C-level Raptor engines installed, while at the same time, work is being carried out on SN9 in the mid-bay. Starship SN9 will, by the way, be the first prototype to fully rely on 304L, so the performance of that prototype will be highly interesting. SN8 still uses 301 in some parts. Meanwhile, the first parts for SN14 have been spotted. Yes, SN14. Soon, SpaceX will need some sort of huge Starship storage space. Because imagine at some point in the not-too-distant future, hundreds of Starships will be standing around and waiting for their turn to launch. Meanwhile, the Super Heavy high bay has gotten roof tiles. So we hope to see Super Heavy stacking still begin this month.
In other news, the Space Force is considering to merge Cape Canaveral with the Kennedy Space Center. Cape Canaveral has historically been used by the Air Force, whereas the Kennedy Space Center has historically been used by NASA. Merging these two launch sites into a single spaceport authority could make sense, especially given the recent proposals of Space Force to cooperate with NASA on many future space missions, about which we talked in this video here. So that of course would offer a higher versatility and of course enable Space Force to launch personnel in the future on NASA missions more easily. For example, joint NASA and Space Force missions to the moon with the Starship? This is some nice food for thought and certainly a very interesting development. Also an interesting development is that NASA is already preparing their deep space communications network for the Artemis 1 mission. For our new viewers, Artemis 1 is the first mission of the Artemis Moon program, which aims to return humans to the moon by 2024. It will be still unmanned and unwomanned, but it will test already all systems for the later missions, which will then have astronauts on board.
The systems being the SLS rocket and the Orion capsule. The launch date is currently scheduled for the end of 2021. And we can see that 3 networks will be used. In Earth's vicinity, the Near-Earth network will be used, which consists of ground stations worldwide that provide direct-to-ground communications and navigation services, controlled by the Goddard Space Flight Center. NASA's Space Network which is also based at Goddard, can provide near continuous communication services to spacecraft through a constellation of tracking and data relay satellites that are located about 22,000 miles above Earth.
The Deep Space Network is an international array of large radio antennas which are also being used to communicate with NASA's interplanetary probes. So yeah, it seems that NASA is really preparing for Artemis 1, which certainly is a good sign. And did you notice that this time we managed not to even rant about SLS? Can you imagine what willpower this required to hold back all this time and not to rant about SLS? I mean, but this willpower is now completely spent.
Then we can finally talk about the really hilarious withdrawal of Chris Ferguson from the first manned Boeing Starliner flight, which will probably take place in late 2021. The official reason being that he wants to put his family first, which is absolutely understandable, and we are totally with him on this, because him and his family would certainly have a very bad feeling about having him fly on a capsule which encountered many bugs on the first unmanned test flight, a flight which nearly ended in total destruction of the Starliner capsule last December. So his motivation of flying on that totally bug-ridden piece of dangerous hardware is understandably not really high. Of course, he isn't really allowed to say that openly. No problem, Chris Ferguson, you have asked for that. So we will say out loud what you formulated so diplomatically. We don't have any insight into Chris Ferguson's private life, but we dare to claim that he might have decided otherwise. Would he have been assigned to a mission which would have used SpaceX's Crew Dragon as a means of transport to the ISS? This is of course just a theory, but nonetheless, it shows once again that Boeing's Starliner might be DOA. If and when it finally can fly reliably to the ISS without encountering bugs, errors or other problems, it might already be far too late for Boeing, since Crew Dragon by then will probably have already flown 5 times to the ISS with astronauts on board, thus making the Starliner completely obsolete. We think that Chris made the right decision, as we also wouldn't be too eager to beta test Starliner while sitting inside this thing on a real mission.
And talking about Starliner software bugs, NASA seems to be repeating those mistakes now for the SLS. We talked about it in this video here.
So thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, on to the future!